in 2005 by some more people. And over time, volunteers have churned in and out in terms of stepping up to take the mantle forward and organize meetups and workshops and stuff. So completely
Hello.
non-profit. We
Hello.
try to keep these meetups free. It's for the community, from the community. So that's the sort of churn that we, the sort of to and fro that we expect and provide. So I have been working with Bank Vipers for the past 5 years now, close to 5 years. Then Anirudh and Ritesh and Rahul and now Aditi, we've all come together to be like co-organizers of the meetup group. We always keep welcoming volunteers because the amount of work that is required is substantial, and it's always helpful to have more hands, and people who are invested in the language can stay for the community as well. That said, that's what, like, we have it typically on the third Saturday of every month. We are constantly looking for talks and speakers and stuff. So this time we are, like, most honored to have Dr. Nipun, Dr. Anupama, and Anushree, like, say, give us the time to talk. So thank you. And I think we're going to start now. So Dr. Nipun, the stage is yours. You can talk about the topic, about yourself a little bit, and then we can go right to the talk.
Sure. Thanks. Right. So I'll just start off where you left off, talking about the different domains and things. So I hope you can see, and I'm going to touch some of these domains in my talk. So currently I'm an assistant professor at IIT Gandhinagar. Prior to that, I was a postdoc researcher, and then I did my PhD. And before that, I was doing a bachelor's of engineering and computer science, and that's where I'm going to talk about the journey. So it's going to be a talk about my experience. So don't think of this as a Gyan talk where you'll get to know, learn some new facets. No, you won't. This is maybe some mistakes I made, some lessons I learned, and I just want to keep it very interactive. Because again, as I said, this is not a technical talk, right? So I'll get started now, and I've labeled this Python. So the session was Python in the Wild, and this is some experiences from my about 12 odd years of usage of Python. So this is a photograph of me with my teammates, and this is a unmanned aerial vehicle. So you can just notice that this is an old photo by looking at the monitors and how thick they were, and you can also probably look at, so I am the person sitting in the middle,
Oh, oops,
you can.
oops, oops. I think we can't see your screen. I don't know. Is it just me?
I can see
I can
your
see
screen.
I can see.
Show stream or something. Watch stream, connect to stream, or some icon. It pops up on Nipun.
Okay, got you. Yeah, thanks. Thank you. Sorry. Go ahead.
Yeah, and you can also figure out this is an old photo by looking at me. Like, I look much younger than what I currently am. So this is pre the hair graying era. So this was a competition that we took part in. This is held in the US, organized by the US Navy. And the objective of this is to, you have to fly an unmanned aerial vehicle, and you have to fly it autonomously. And you have to fly it autonomously, and you have to capture some photos, and you have to do some.
Website the contact the
Mute everyone.
Then everyone who is not a speaker, mute yourself. MGR, continue.
I have muted. Let's continue.
Right. So the objective was to fly over certain waypoints, capture some photos, images, and then based on that, you have to do some image tracking and you have to do some waypoint navigation. So this was in my. We started off this project after my first year in engineering. This is in Delhi College of Engineering. And this is when we went to the competition, all very young, enthusiastic chaps trying to, firstly acclimatize to the different environment. This was my first flight also, directly from Delhi to Maryland, we flew. And I think we did okay. To be honest, we did not do a very good job. We got some award for the best effort, And that was primarily because the organizers saw a struggle with the hardware and not being able to get this to fly in the air very well. So I was mostly looking at the ground control station for this. So the ground control station, this is the interface that I built up. Now, as you can probably guess from this, this is a Java application. This is the first year competition that we went in, and this was horrible. So this, these are some of the things you should not do. You should not create such a horrible interface. And I ended up using Java without having much background on Java threads and things. So, and there was a multiple threads I was looking at for, like, some of the threads had to read the data. So the data was being transferred. So just to explain the full setup. So this is the plane which will be flying in the air. There'll be a radio link down, and that through that radio link, I'll be getting the data which I have to show, and then I can also send command up to the plane. So it's the RC plane. Now the data I would be reading in, and then I would also be having the, I want to have the options of clicking certain things and sending the commands up. So this is a very naive interface that I ended up creating. And at that point of time, I was not very well conversant with threads and how to do, you know, build good applications. So I created a very naive inter-process communication or inter-thread communication model. And any guesses what that was? What is the most naive method you could use to communicate data between different threads and processes? So I ended up using files, flat files. I would store data from one thread into a flat file, and I would read the data from the flat file for the other thread. That's incredibly slow because now you're dealing with the speed of the disk rather than dealing with the speed of the memory. And this was again sort of a lesson that at that point of time, I thought that projects and academics need to be, you know, there's no relationship between them. But now as a faculty, when I am teaching these courses and I'm teaching this operating systems courses, I understand that had I well studied the operating systems course, I could have very easily understood that what needs to be done and the interprocess communication or the piping mechanisms that need to be built. So this is the first year we went for the competition. We won the best effort award for all the hardware stuff that we were able to do. Next year, I decided that I'm going to ditch away the old user interface and I'm building something from scratch. The idea was to build something cross-platform. So that just removed the option of something like Visual Studio and building something in Visual C++. So there were some suggestions from the team that we were, so we thought we could build it in Qt. And so this is a same framework which is used by KDE. And it's a very beautiful framework. The interface is very nice. And most importantly, it's cross-platform. So I started building, just getting familiar with this. But this, the default, the basic, you know, the most of the examples for this are firstly written in C and C++, I think. And then you have a version which is PyQt, which is Python bindings for this. I somehow also then went and looked at GTK and Glade, so which is the one which is used for the GNOME desktop environment. So again, pretty similar. The software experience is probably was not as easy or as rich as say Visual Studio. But this was still a pretty good interface that I could use to build certain applications. So at this point of time, I also looked at another ground control station, which was by a PhD student in New Zealand called John Stars. And this was really what we needed. This was amazing. And this was also around the same time. So this is around 2009 or so. This was around the same time that GitHub was becoming popular. Like it was a launch along the same time only. Before that, people were using SourceForge or other things. So this was very interesting times in the Python community. That also, and also a lot of open source community was really picking up because of the GitHub was being adopted. So this was what I've set out to build. But again, I think I was very naive at that point of time. I ended up writing horrible looking code like this. So you can see that there is jimble.py. So jimble is just to ensure that the camera is always stable. And this particular line of code that you see, it's called downlink underscore 1 underscore 38 underscore tcp.py. So this was, so think of it as I was, this is for reading the data from the serial port that was being transferred wirelessly to the radio from the plane. And just looking at this code, you can probably understand that how horrible software engineering
is. Nipun, I think we're missing a screen or something, because we don't see the gimbal.py, the TCP, none of it. Only the slide is being seen.
I mean, on the slide, do you see the? Do you see?
No, no. I see. Just an image. A regular expression.
Is that the slide you intend to be showing, Nipun?
So it's slide number 9, poor code 1.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Okay. I see the files.
Yeah, everything in the slide itself. Right. Yeah. I don't even have a GitHub repository for this. So just showing how horrible code like some of us might have written. At least I wrote. And this _1_38 is indicating that this is 38th version of the file. So I was not using version control at that point of time. And this is also an email I wrote to myself in order to back up my code. Like I was not storing it up on GitHub. So this is again showing the journey of how horrible things have been. Like I just laugh at this now, looking at this, what are the things I used to do back then. And this was an active blog that our team maintained. So if you see this virtual cockpit image, this is what I ended up making when I wanted to make something like this. But nevertheless, this was a functional interface. And there were some other widgets that I kept on creating. So in the next year's competition, we had much better luck. Like we went on and won some other award also. It was a much better overall experience. And so this was during my undergrad and my undergrad. So I was just about to finish my undergrad at this point of time. And at this point, I'll move over and I'll talk about some of the other projects. And I'll show the different aspects of Python that I did. So after my undergrad, I had worked for a very small time in an industry. So I worked as a software engineer in Royal Bank of Scotland. Prior to that, during my undergrad, I was an intern at Goldman Sachs. I somehow didn't find the atmosphere very congenial to my likes and expertise. So I ended up moving and did my PhD from IIT Delhi. So that's where I've started working on sustainability problems, on smart meters, how can we improve the energy efficiency of buildings, right? So while motivating this, I usually start with this picture. So can anyone tell me what this picture is from which movie? Does anyone remember this?
Adesh.
Right. So so if you know this picture, then this basically tells you that you are from that era. So this is the set of people who were very motivated, who were very inspired by this movie when this bulb lights up in that village of Charanpur. But even recently, the case is that a lot of the population does not have access to electricity. If you remove the developed world, so a lot of the other developing or underdeveloped world still does not have access to electricity. So this was the main problem statement I worked with. And in this exercise during my PhD, I had to look at various different applications, various different aspects of Python for solving various challenges in my PhD. So this is some of the motivation. I'm just going to cut through it. So buildings consume most of the energy. And if we can remove or we can reduce that energy, we can sort of make a dent towards people not having enough access to electricity. And there are various ways in which electricity consumption can be used. Reduced. One is to construct newer efficient buildings, but most of the buildings have already been constructed, so this is out of question. The other is retrofitting, so replace all the appliances with efficient appliances. This is again a very high return on, like very low return on investment. So the third aspect is to improve the user behavior. Can you figure out, so this was a small exercise done by a company called OPAR. They just, at the end of each month, they just gave you a smiley or a frown face, depending on your energy consumption being higher or lower than the neighbors. And that itself led people to improve their energy consumption without actually having to do anything else. So this is showing the behavioral aspect of reducing energy consumption, right? So I'm going to skip this video. The idea that we are now dealing during my PhD, I was dealing with was, so think of instead of just your monthly bill, which is a single number, can I give you an itemized bill? So this is similar to, let's say you go to a grocery store or some mall, or let's say you go to a Reliance store, right? You don't get a single number. If you get a single number, you can't come back home and realize that, oh, you could have spent lesser on these things, right? But the electricity bill that we mostly get is a single number, so we can't do much about it. So I dealt with this problem called energy breakdown, where the idea is, can we break down the bill into how much energy each appliance consumes, right? An itemized bill. And this has been shown in research to help reduce up to 15% energy, because people are more aware of where their energy is going. They can take some actions towards it. Right. So the simplest way to do this is to install a sensor called an appliance energy monitor on each plug. This is expensive, does not scale well, right? So in order to study this aspect, this notion of scalability of these appliance level monitors, I did a deployment in my home. So this is various different appliances that I have in my home, and this is the floor layout. So I have an air conditioner, electric iron, geyser, laptop, air conditioner, refrigerator, water purifier, motor, etc. And these are the various sensors that I installed. Now, the way I did this was that I installed a smart meter. Let's see if I have a smart meter image. So this was a deployment that I did, and this is where again I started using Python a lot. So I was installing these bunch of sensors. One of them is a smart meter. So smart meter is just like your regular analog meter at home. Let's see if I can pull up an image of that. Right. So this is a smart meter, just like a regular analog meter which you have in your home. But this can tell you your electricity consumption in real time. So think of it as it has a communication interface, and you can attach a Raspberry Pi, you can attach any single boot computer to it. So I ended up attaching a Raspberry Pi to it and retrieving the data from it. So this data was transmitted. This data can be pulled over the serial link. So this is an RS-485 Modbus connection. So this is the first time this is the first place which I used Python during my PhD in terms of interfacing with the hardware. Now I ended up using PySerial library. Now, another interesting thing with the PySerial library is that I spent one full day where I could not figure out why my code is not working. And the reason was that the code that I'd written was called PySerial.py. And that I was import PySerial, the library. And I already had a .pyc generated. I could not understand what was the dependency, right? So one lesson, don't name your file with the name of the module that you're trying to import. So we were getting this smart meter data. So every 1 second, I was getting about 40 parameters related to power, like the current, the voltage, the phase, the apparent power, the voltage, the frequency, etc. I was getting these 40 odd parameters every second, storing it into the SBC. Now the single boot computer, the Raspberry Pi, was also limited. So I had to create a networked infrastructure where the data from the Raspberry Pi was now being transmitted periodically to a bigger machine in my home, because I didn't want to fill up the Raspberry Pi also. And also for data logging purposes, I didn't want to lose any data in case anything happened with the hardware. So I ended up writing another set of Python scripts, which would basically be run via the cron track. Every X hours, it would upload the data to the server. Now, how do you upload the data to the server, to the other computer? So I had to build up yet another Python link, which was to build up this server application. So let's see if I can show you my server code. So let's see, smart meter file upload. So I ended up using this small web package called web.py. So what I ended up doing was, and if you can see this root and password as the MySQL credentials, and this is public on GitHub. So I was looking for all the files which were CSV, which were created, and if they were older than some threshold time, I would then store them into the database. So this is the database I was creating. And I think I have... Right, so these were the URLs I was uploading them to. So this is the post method. So every X hours, I would make a post request to a server, which was also sitting in my home. And I would then upload the data on the server, then I would store it on the database. So this was again showing how gradually I was incorporating all things Python into my setup. this was a very crucial step so that we didn't end up losing any data. On the server, then I had to again build up some scripts which would do some sanity checks so that, you know, the voltage is not 5000 volts or you're not missing any data. So gradually over time, I was building up this entire infrastructure, which was fairly resilient. And a key feature of this resiliency was that there were multiple points where I would store the data so that there is no loss. And I did not want to rely on the cell tower. Like, I did not want to rely on even my home internet. So everything was done locally. So this was also a lot of redundant effort in terms of setting up the routers, ensuring that the routers are bridged, and ensuring that the data, you know, everything is assigned a static IP. Each of the devices in the home is assigned a static IP so that you don't end up messing that up. So this was the smart meter deployment that I did. And this brought in various different interesting aspects. Now, you might think that homes are easy to sense, but they are not. Homes are very hazardous. You know, like if someone was cleaning the home, they could very easily snap a wire. This was connected to one of the sensor. Aesthetics do matter. Like, you don't want your bedtime view to be something like this. This is a plug computer. This is an additional router that I placed. And interestingly, homes are very poor connectivity. So this was the place where I had my fridge and I was not getting any connectivity there. So this was very incredibly hard to get a sensor fixed there so that it could upload the data. And the setup I installed, I did electricity monitoring at various levels. Smart meter, I've already told. The appliance level, this was yet another device, this big box, which could tell how much each appliance was consuming, and also at the circuit breaker level. Right. So there were various other interesting aspects that came out. This was a study I did in 2013 in Delhi. So in the US, we see that the voltage fluctuation is very less than 1% of the stipulated voltages. But in India, I was seeing the quartile spread to be about 9%. This has significantly improved over the years, but this was the case. And if I look the voltage versus time, I could also see that the voltage drops significantly around midnight. So this is around the time peak summer when almost every home has multiple ACs and all of them are running. So this was an interesting observation. There were a lot of blackouts, brownouts during the day, and I had some statistics around them. But the important thing was from this entire lesson was this entire deployment was that one, you should be collecting data if you can. So this gives you a lot of interesting understanding into the problem statement. So a lot of studies in the West have said that you could do this deployment, you know, it's easy to collect that data. We realize it's very expensive. Each sensor is expensive, especially if you convert it into the Indian earning and the amount of the cost that it cost for all the shipping and customs, etc. These sensors cost a lot. These don't scale well. And your network connectivity is an issue inside the home also. So these then made us realize that, you know, we need to do something better, which requires lesser number of sensors. And this is where we looked at something called non-intrusive load monitoring. The idea is to remove the intrusion from the home. So we don't want to install all of these sensors. Instead, from the smart meter, we are getting this data, time series data. We will use this process called non-intrusive load monitoring, which is just machine learning, and break down this signal into the constituent appliance, right? So the idea is that each appliance shows some unique signature, like your air conditioner will turn, the compressor will turn on and off. The fridge also will have a compressor turn on and off. So this is the basic idea of NEL. Now, this is a very old field. This field started around the time India won the World Cup, Cricket World Cup for the first time. I was not even born then. But even when I was doing this research, it was impossible to tell which machine learning method to use. So this is where my second main Python contribution came in. We created this open source machine learning toolkit called LimTK, which provided datasets in common format, provided baseline algorithms, and a suite of metrics. Now, this is very interesting, especially for those who are interested in research. People will suggest you research, don't build tools, don't waste time in engineering. But I will just want to give you a proof as to why this is important. This is a problem. Can you request, please, everyone to be on mute?
Yes, I am muting people actively based on...
I see. Sure, thank you. So this is a toolkit paper which we published, and this has been cited the most in all of my papers, right? So this just shows that building tools for the community where you feel engaged with and which are important to solve problems, even though they are engineering challenges, this is an important thing to do, right? So this has been about 6, 7, 8 years, and I'm still actively contributing to the tool, and it's written in Python. So this was an important lesson. So multiple papers are using this tool, multiple people have proposed algorithms, we've won a bunch of awards, right? The key lesson was that reproducibility and tools go a long way. The key thing is to understand where the opportunity lies. And at this point of time, I started working now really into hardcore machine learning, right? So this is where I ended up building up a lot of my expertise in gradually. And in the interest of time, I'm going to skip a lot of these things. Otherwise, the program will get highly delayed. But one of the most important thing that I did was during this whole process was to build up my blog very regularly. And if I can just show that. So in my blog, I was very regularly writing different articles. So this was mostly myself trying to understand the various aspects of machine learning, statistics, etc. And these ended up explaining a lot to me. So the idea was that can you boil down everything to addition and subtraction, right? There are some non-trivial things which you have to do in machine learning. For example, this is now dynamic time warping. Some of you might have already used this. This is a distance metric. Think of it as like a Euclidean metric, but this is more adaptable, specifically if you have signatures which can have different times, different time durations. For example, if I speak hello versus hello, I've spoken one with a slightly longer duration, but both of them are the same thing, right? So if you have to do some kind of feature mapping, or if you have to tell whether these both are from the same person or not, you can't use Euclidean metric because these are two of different lengths, right? So what I ended up doing across my PhD and even now as a faculty, I do this, is to boil down to a problem to a very simplistic thing. And I would write Jupyter notebooks. I would try and write this blog post for myself, which I would have found useful on reading. And some of them took off on Hacker News. Some of them were very popular, and I use them in my lectures also now. But this I felt was a very important exercise to try and learn while you're explaining things, right? And I can very honestly attest to this fact that now as a faculty, now I'm learning things for the first time. The courses I should have learned during my undergrad, I didn't learn them at all. Now when I'm teaching those courses, that's when I'm learning. And the way I now sort of suggest everyone to learn in my lectures, in my classes, is to try and boil down the problem to simplest example you can write some code for, right? There are difficult concepts, mathematically difficult concepts. Let's say we talk about expectation maximization. Now, again, can I boil it down to something which is, some things which are interactive, right? Which help me explain. Wherever I can write some code, I find it much more easier than understanding some mathematical equations. So this has been my recipe for trying to understand various of these things. And I ended up writing quite a few of these blog posts. So let's see. So AdaGrad. So AdaGrad is now an optimizer many of you will be using in, like Adam, it's an optimizer you would be using in machine learning. So again, I've tried to explain it with some very trivial examples. There are some animations which will show the specific impact of the different parameters. And in between, I would also do some weekend fun projects. Like that was one of the category in your Discord set of links also. So for example, I was doing this ggplot visualizations in Python. So these are some visualizations I picked up from, right. So there's this article, top 50 ggplot visualizations in R. I tried to write the same thing in Python. Some of them were trivial, some of them were not. So that's a very wonderful exercise if you can sort of play around with different visualization libraries. So that's one of my interests, sort of thing I do when I get bored. So it's my de-stressor in some sense. So these are various things that I did now more recently. And like, so this is one of the recent paper that I also replicated. This is now, if you look at the mass, it's probably scary. But at the end of the day, this just boils down to writing some code in NumPy and SciPy and then doing some matplotlib visualizations. I've also learned this is also very useful when you have various very amazingly built tools like AutoGrad and Jax, all these days, specifically for a machine learning researcher. I just end up by showing some of the work which we are doing in the space of air quality. So the idea is that poor air quality in India is reducing life expectancy by about 6 years. The major problem that we're trying to solve is that there's a dearth of air quality monitors in India. So the idea is, can we use machine learning and specifically some non-Bayesian parametrics to understand, to estimate the air quality at unmonitored locations? The other thing that we're trying to do is, can you suggest where to install the next air quality monitor? So this is again now something known as active learning in machine learning. And we're trying to propose some domain-inspired features. So we're looking at something called Gaussian processes. So this is active learning. Another thing we're trying to do is to build some low-cost variables, right? So my work delves somewhat in variables and hardware, as well as in applied machine learning. So this is a variable which we're trying to seek, and about the size of a coin, which can measure your personal exposure, not the ambient air pollution level, but the exposure. And interestingly, again, I am trying to build up some tools for air quality research. Whether the research community appreciates or not, I think these tools are important so that you reduce the amount of effort you do in the long run. And generally, someone will also find them useful. So for air quality research, we built up some tools which lower the entry barrier towards air quality data download, towards research. And I think this is where Aditi and her group have also built up some amazing tools. But we've been building something like this for the past 3-4 years without having very sustained effort towards this. This is the air quality interpolation level plot that we can now write in about 4 or 5 lines of code. But if you don't use, but if you try to write it from scratch using existing libraries, it's a lot of effort. It's a calendar plot which shows the direction of wind, which is causing the most pollution. And right, so I'll just stop at this point. I think I've already shot up by 1 minute. Although we started a little late, but I'll stop at this point. I'll want to take questions, discussions.
So, thank you, Dr. Nipun. This was actually very informative. Now, a couple of things stood out, right? First thing is the importance of documentation. That's something that I found useful as well. Always document your learnings and keep writing what you're learning, and it might serve, if nothing else, as a reference to you only in the future, right? So a technical blog is very useful to maintain, I think. And you also mentioned a couple of things. First thing is the smart meter that you installed. How trivial is it to install? Is it a drop-in replacement?
Sure. So I'll first answer your first question or first comment about documenting. So again, I'll be very honest that while I tried my blog post to be generally applicable, but I am the number one consumer of my blog post. I am the number one consumer of all the documentation, all the beautiful markdown notes of all the GitHub repositories that I end up writing. And you might find it odd, but so this is also something I've been looking. So each time I take a lecture, I often end up looking at my previous year's lecture recordings also. So many times, it's in the moment, we're excited by various things, as all of us as engineers or researchers, scientists, of trying to build new things. But that extra effort spent in trying to just document your learnings is very useful. And someday or the other, if your project takes off, there'll be a lot of people will keep on asking questions. It's important to just write them as an FAQ on the website. Coming to your second question about the smart meter. So I forgot to tell this. The code that I'd written, in fact, let me just very quickly go over that. Let's see if I have. Right, so this repository called Smart Meter. So if you see, the final edit was done on 23rd March 2014. So this is the simple code that I had written. And if I can see, let me go to configuration.py. Right, so this is basically showing that you're using PyModbus or some serial library. So interestingly, this code served as the starter code, which my advisor then built on, and he created a company. So he created this company called Zenetix. I'm sure they would have improved the code significantly. But this is a company based out of Gurgaon, run by, so it's led by my then PhD advisor, Dr. Amarjeet Singh. And they have installed smart meters in a large volume across different retail outlets, different energy verticals in India. And they've reduced the energy consumption of many of them by 10, 20, 30%, something like that. But I'm very happy, very proud that the at least the initial version, some part of it I wrote during my PhD thesis for smart meter deployment. Now the smart meter deployment, the smart meter would cost something between 5 to 20,000, depending on the variant that you get. Installation is not that difficult, but you need something known as a current transformer also, and that you need to appropriately match to your load in the home. What we did was that we made this smart meter sit before the main meter. Now, the electricity company, at least the one which is in my hometown, they were not approving of that, and we had to remove it after some point of time. In many parts of India now, smart meters are actually being installed. So I think a trained electrician could do this in about an hour or less. But the someone who's deploying smart meters, for them this should be about 5 to 10 minutes of work. You just need to switch all the supply, just get the current, just get the correct current transformer. So this is, that is a clamp-on thing which you put across a couple of wires, and then you need to connect some interface like RS-485 to USB interface, and you can connect the, you can get the data into a Raspberry Pi or a computer.
Got it. Yeah, I was also going to ask about regulations, but you also already answered that. Yeah, if it is accepted by electricity boards and stuff, that is also a factor to consider. Right. And you mentioned a couple of libraries. I don't know if I captured them all. PySerial, was it?
Right. So PySerial is an existing, so it's a very popular serial package for reading, right? So if you see, yes, right. So it's very popular, 2.4K starts. This is for reading data from serial port. So we had various devices. So most of the hardware you'll see will give you data over the serial port.
Okay.
And so now what that means is that you'll eventually have to get some kind of a converter, which gives you data over the USB port. That's generally what you end up doing.
Got it. Cool. Those were my questions. No, if anyone else has any questions, I have unmuted people who had previously muted. So please go ahead and ask.
Can you please tell us how the networking was done between the devices in Python?
Right. So that I didn't do in Python. That was manually done. So I ended up getting, I think it was a Netgear router, a couple of Netgear routers. Okay. And I manually got, so I got the IP addresses of each of them, and I manually allocated that. Having said that, so there are various other things I now use Python for. So, for example, I am now the publication chair for a conference called COTS-COMAT. Some of you might have heard it, heard about it. It's this year, 2022, it's also going to be held in Bangalore. So it's the leading data science venue in India, COTS-COMAT. So I'm the proceedings chair there, and I had to prepare the proceedings. I had to prepare the list of papers which are being published and get them in a very specific format. Again, I ended up using Python. I had to get my Google Scholar data. So I had to get this, my publications in some specific format. Again, ended up exporting this and then reading it in Pandas and doing a bunch of data munging. So it's been a life.
Does Google Scholar not offer APIs?
No, officially they don't.
Watch, you scrape it at best.
Yeah, right.
Cool. One last question I had was with respect to the open source package that you are developing. Probably, is it reserved only for students to contribute, or people outside can also contribute? Is it?
So, no. We have absolutely no reservations. Like, the more people contribute, the better it is. So, in fact, if I do that. Let's see. Right. So this is like this one of the packages. We appropriately named it by you. And so it's based on an R package called OpenAir. But we're just trying to because I'm a Python user. I'm just trying to make things easier. And so the other thing was that to build it up in Python pipelines. There are extensive, some beautiful Python pipelines which exist, including the machine learning data was in pipelines. You don't want to be doing something in R, something in Python, and then... So this was the one of the ideas also, to lower the entry barrier. And this is also, yeah, this is open to anyone.
Right. I remember, like, when I was doing my MTech thesis, I wrote the project in R, and then we had to use an interface to convert from R to Python, and then, set it up with the rest of the code. So I get the...
Yeah, R can break. It did break.
Cool. So the reason I asked about the open source project is because I'm sure there are people here who would like to contribute to it. So all of these links, I'll be putting it in the Discord channel, either in the event QA that Ani has created or in the general section. So if there are any more questions, you can ask them in the event QA channel. Dr. Nipun, thank you so much for this. I would really appreciate if you put in all the links also. On the
also advertise that we also all generally have some JRF positions, so junior research fellow, and people want to contribute to these tools, they want to explore whether they like to be in a part of the research setup or not, they can try that out. It's a low commitment project. It's a 1 year project. You don't have to sort of sign up for a 5 year PhD. Then you can go back to your job. If you don't like it, come back, do a PhD, do an MTech, something like that. I'll post all of these relevant links.
Super. Yeah, typically, we tell speakers that you should not advertise your jobs and all, but academia, I think I'm going to make that exemption because, more people should get into academics and academicians should, get in more industrial experienced people also there. So, yeah, I mean, it's pretty fortunate that you have the Python know-how to balance the mathematical skill set as well, so you can write code for your own formulae, right? Otherwise, there's a gap between the two, generally, I've seen.
Right.
So, cool. All right. Now we will move on.
Thank you.
Next is Anushree. Welcome, Anushree. Thank you for making time on a Saturday. And Anushree is going to be talking about Python data science in wildlife or data sources for wildlife, so I'll let her talk about the rest of it. So welcome, Anushree.
Hi everyone. Thank you, Abhiram, and thank you everyone for attending this and sparing your weekend time for this. So I'll just share my screen. Am I audible?
Oh yes, you are. Yeah.
Great. Yeah. So just to set a background, I work as a data scientist in Wildlife Conservation Society.
One thing, I'm sorry. Everyone has to click on the watch stream. That's when you'll be able to click watch the stream. Right. So that's all. Please go on.
Yeah. So I work as a data scientist in Wildlife Conservation Society, and we are a very small team, like a team of two people, me and Shama, who is also attending this talk. And we are trying to implement different data science solutions and some kind of automation in the field of conservation research. So it's just been more than a year, or one and a half year that we are trying to implement this solution. So it's in a very preliminary phase. So as Abhiram has correctly pointed out that, people in academics do need suggestions and comments from people from different industries. So please feel free to comment and suggest as we go through the presentation. So, let's begin with it. I'll be talking about how Python is being used in the field of wildlife conservation, and more than being used, how it has speeded up the conservation efforts in past few years. So starting with the one of the areas, like I tried to look into different areas within wildlife conservation, and starting with illegal wildlife trade, the area which I'm very much familiar with, and we have been working in this area within WCAS. So as most of you might have heard of this term called illegal wildlife trade, maybe first time during this pandemic, because this is one of the suspected cause of COVID-19 outbreak. So just to give you a brief of what illegal wildlife trade is, the wild animals and their derived products are sold for different purposes across the world. So it's basically a transnational crime, and so basically the seller is in different country and the buyer is in different country, and it's a huge market. Like it's a very well organized crime, and it's the fourth largest after narcotics and human trafficking. So you can see the scale at which it operates. The value of illegal wildlife trade ranges from 7 to 23 billion per year. But in the end, if you see, the Indian Wildlife Protection Act has just 7 years of maximum jail term for the culprits or the traffickers. So that's why it is very less addressed. And within the trafficking network or the within illicit trade network, it is considered as less risky, trade. The nature of trade is less risky for the traffickers. So, as I said, it is less addressed, but there are various ways to address this issue. And even the enforcements across the world are on toes to, like, you know, to, since it has become a global concern now after this pandemic, everybody is on toes to address this as soon as possible. So, I can point out mainly the three areas where, you know, Python can come into the picture. So the very first is like analyzing the criminal networks. Unlike other illicit trades, it's very limited to, like, you know, the countries where biodiversity, which are rich in biodiversity, like India. So if you see, it's a transnational crime. So there are it is very important to understand how the trade network works across India and outside India. So there are porous boundaries through which the trade happens. Also, just to set a background why this trade happens, there are different reasons. So one of this, you might have heard the traditional Chinese medicines or the traditional medicinal practices that are carried out across South Asian countries, for which rhino horn or the pangolin, which is again an endangered animal, is and its products like the pangolin scale or the skin is being sold. So right from charismatic species like elephant, rhinos, till the, like, you know, smallest birds are involved in this, like all these species are included in this entire trade network. And the way it functions is very interesting to understand, because it also depends on species wise. Since the species abundance is different in different areas, the trade routes are different for different species. So that is again an important point to note and understand why, how the trade network functions. To understand this network, the very first step is to have the data in, like, you know, a kind of centralized repository, and then tools like IBM i2 can be used for the analysis. So IBM i2 is basically a tool that can turn your data into, like, you know, useful actionable insights and intelligence. So it can also tell you about how the repeated offenders are, or what are the important trade routes, or what are the important seizure locations. So in order to analyze, we have to have a centralized repository. So in our ongoing work, which has also received a grant from Google under Google AI for Social Good projects, we are trying to make a consolidated database of wildlife crime incidences. So what is the data available to us? It's basically, we are trying to use open source data that is available across internet. The very first is like the media reports. So media reports usually talk about different seizure incidences that have taken place across the country. And these media reports are in different languages. And it contains the information like which are the species being sold, which was the authority who took the seizure, and like, you know, who did the investigation, or the people involved or the officers involved in it. So all this information need to be extracted from the media reports, or there are court judgments. So there are a few online portals where court judgments are publicly available to analyze. And then some social media handles of enforcement. So Wildlife Crime Control Bureau, also like their official Facebook and like, you know, social media handles do keep posting about the recent seizures that that have taken place. So all this information is again scattered. So the challenges here are the information is multimodal, in a sense that there are different data types to handle, like it's text, it's multimedia, and then there are some PDFs, like where we have to use OCR techniques to process it. And the information is in, like, you know, 10 plus different regional languages. And here the catch is, we can't really ignore the media reports in regional languages, because most of the times, those reports contain more information than, you know, any nationwide newspaper like Times of India or Indian Express. The local newspaper tend to contain better and detailed information of the seizure. So we can't really, you know, ignore regional level information, regional language information, sorry. So yeah. So how we are trying to achieve this? So first is like, I'll just talk about few of the open source data, few of the Python open source packages that we have been using. For the data collection, Google News has a Python wrapper. There are a couple of wrappers, but we are using GNews. Then if you might have heard of GDLT, it's a huge repository of newspapers in which has live translation in 65 different languages. So it's an open source project. Again, it is backed by Google and it is publicly available. So GDLT also has a Python binding, which we are trying to use. Then for the other newspapers where, you know, which cannot be, or the local newspapers say, which are very region specific. So we are using some focus crawlers to search through those websites and, like, you know, get the, so we have a set of keywords like pangolin scales for sale, pangolin skins for sale. So these keywords we have just noted down, and we'll be using this, we'll be passing these keywords to the crawler, and crawler will take out the important pages and the relevant pages for us. Then for Twitter, it's a TweetPy is a very standard, like, you know, and there are lots of libraries rather, which uses official Twitter API. And for Facebook, it's little tricky to get the data, but there is an open source package called Facebook Scraper, which allows you to scrape through public pages and groups. So and there are a lot of, like, you know, other small packages that we have been still exploring. As I said, it's in a very initial stage. We are still exploring different ways to collect the data. And then comes the data processing. So there is an amazing wrapper called Newspaper 3K, which allows you to extract the content of the newspaper using the RSS feeds and to process it. And it has some functionalities of NLP, like it gives you a summary of article, it gives you the important keywords, though it is very much, like, you know, based on the frequency of words and not very contextual, but it's, since it's an open source and very easy to integrate, we have been using Newspaper 3K. And GenSim is basically a text mining and texture processing library, which has, which is actually famous for topic modeling area within NLP. Once that is, like, you know, the processing is again like a very crucial part here, because we have to extract right information from the news articles. But the thing is, we tend to get, like, you know, thousands of news articles. If you just type wildlife crime on Google News, you will get hundreds of results, which are not all of them are useful for us. So we have kind of, you know, built a classification model to sort out the resultant pages based on our use case and which are relevant to us, which talks about wildlife crime or seizure incidences, and which are more like, you know, not crime related articles. So relevant versus irrelevant, we are trying to classify with the simple scikit-learn logistic regression. We have made a very, very basic and simple model, which may modify in the, like, you know, coming days. Then comes, like, as I said, information extraction is one of the important component here, which also takes you to the next step of relationship extraction. Like, in the name entity recognition, identifying entities is one part. Finding the relation between them, like, mainly, like, just to give you an example, a seizure report contains, like, you know, suspect name, suspect age, and their location, their origin. So all these, like, you know, associated information needs to be mapped to the suspect name. So the relationship extraction within SPASI, and there are other NAR libraries as well, which we are exploring, but currently the base model we have built is using SPASI. Then geocoding. So usually the seizure report will have a seizure incident, the location of incident where seizure has taken place. And this location will be, you know, sometimes very vague, like this road or this bridge, like connecting this state to some other state. So these location needs to be mapped at city and state and then the country level. So here we are trying to use different geocoding libraries, but starting with the Google Maps, we are still in the exploration phase. And then, as I said, the media reports and even the court judgments sometimes we get are in PDF or like, you know, JPEG format. So OpenCV is something we are trying to use to do the OCR and identify the text out of it, and then again run the natural language processing models to get information. So this is like an overview of the packages that we have been using. Then another area, you know, the another way to address this issue is tracking internet-based crime. So as the entire world has shifted from, like, you know, offline to online mode during this pandemic, even the wildlife trade is no exception to this. And if you can see, the internet-based crime is, like, it's spread across internet. Like, unlike other illicit crimes, if you think of, like, you know, any illegal trade, first thing comes to your mind is dark web. But fortunately or unfortunately, the sellers haven't yet moved to dark web. And it's still easy to track on the surface web. But it's spread across the surface web, like right from social media, YouTubes, then e-commerce website. And there is a very different angle to it within the Indian context. That is a trade that is done for occult practices. So many wild animals and their products are sold for black magic purposes. And, you know, there are tantra mantra websites, which usually, like, publicly put out the listings of these products. So yeah, like, so how we can use this information and provide some intel to enforcement so that they can take this further and start the investigation. So this is a very like, you know, this is a very basic example of how the YouTube video of wildlife raid looks like. So here the seller is trying to sell a red sand boa, and usually they mention the details in, like, you know, description. If you see, please call me on this number, original mere paas available hai. And the interesting part is, if you see the comment section, most of the time it's filled with buyer seller interactions. So someone is trying to sell the product from this location, so they as well mention the location. So we don't want to lose out on, like, you know, all this information to get the, like, you know, insights out of this. And so that, because these are the key things that enforcement can use, like tracing the mobiles, and, you know, this is basically a cybercrime. So to have some evidence, they have to have this information. And currently, at least in India, the enforcements are still trying to cope up with this, like, you know, the new transition of wildlife trade. So we are just trying to help them to, like, you know, by providing this information. Another funny part here is, like, they don't usually use the actual species name. So, like, if you see here, double engine in Bangalore. So here, double engine means the red sand boa. So double engine is a code word used for red sand boa. And so that's how you can see how difficult it is to track, first to trace it. Identifying itself is a big task. So what are we trying to use? Again, the Python YouTube API, YouTube data API. There is a Python wrapper built on top of YouTube data API, which is Python YouTube, and which is very lightweight and amazing. Like, it's very, very easy to integrate. And then we are using some kind of tools, online tools. So, like, a mobile number tracker. So if the comment sections have, or the any comment has any mobile number, then we are just trying to use a focused crawler and trace that mobile number and just see it belongs to which circle, so that at least we can narrow it down to, like, you know, state-wise, if not the exact location. And also we are trying to use NLP techniques to identify location from the comments. And as you can see, in most of the listings, they don't spell the words properly. So even if they want to say parrot, they'll just write triple R or anything like that. So we are also trying to explore different spell checkers within Python, like a text block, to tackle with this issue. So this is about the crime happens on internet, but then let's move on to the something on ground. So predicting the poaching hotspots. So this was a very recent, like a year back, this study was carried out in the Harvard School of Engineering, and they kind of tried to use AI and try to build an AI software using some ground truth data, as well as some camera trap images that we'll talk about it, to predict the poacher's probability within that area. So why is it required? As I said, the entire wildlife trade network, it starts, the very beginning of it is to hunt or poach the animal in a protected area. So the rangers are the rangers are allotted different areas to do the patrolling. But if we could predict the probability of poaching happening in that particular area, then we can strengthen the, you know, patrolling in that particular area. So this is basically an idea behind creating this AI-based software. So the crucial part here is the camera traps, because and not just to understand, like, you know, not just to predict poachers' probability, but camera traps are used across wildlife conservation research, just to understand the, you know, behavior of an animal, then monitor the movements of species, because in the core areas where you can't really sit and track each and every movement of the species, you have to have some kind of sensors to, like, you know, track this movement. So camera traps are basically, like, you know, the digital cameras which use infrared sensors or motion sensors to trace the activity. And so it is usually placed in remote places where the human interference will be as as less as possible. And to process, like, if you see in a forest, there will be lots of activities happening throughout the day, throughout the night. So the huge amount of data will be collected within a trapper. So to process this information, there are some Python libraries, like the TensorFlow is always there to build a deep net model for the object detection. But there are some open source packages which are built on top of, like, you know, the training data that is used wildlife images or the images of wild animals. And it is trained and it is publicly available. It's like a citizen science data set where people have come together and annotated each and every images. So now it has become, like, you know, more accessible. It has wider audience and it is accessible throughout the conservation community now. So Trapper is again one of the camera trap processing software. It is based. It is built using Django. It's a web framework, and it has a very good documentation that, you know, even the people from conservation field which doesn't have a technical background can easily integrate it. And then the camera trap image classifier. So as I said, there are many initiatives in the recent years have taken place in this field, and, like, you know, camera traps being widely used everywhere, there are more and more open source packages coming up. So other than camera traps, if you see bioacoustics, it's again a very interesting field of study. So it's basically studying the wildlife by recording sounds. So, and it's cheaper than camera traps, and it can range over the larger area. So again, there are some open source toolkits like MAD soundscape analysis, and it is used for species like very smallest species to like frogs. So frogs have been studied using the bioacoustics. Because camera traps, that's a limitation of camera traps and where bioacoustics come into the picture. And to process this huge amount of data, because bioacoustics will have all kinds of, all sorts of sound within the forest. So to classify the sounds and, take out the useful for your research, is again a big task for the conservation researcher. So there have been useful packages coming up in that area as well. And then there is a Pi Research Insight. So you might have heard of a lot of Python packages, open source packages, which are give the text analysis, like a summary of a scientific text or the literature. But this particular package is meant for ecological research papers. So all the scientific publications which are related to conservation and ecology, it's very efficient in doing the text analysis on top of that. So these are some key applications other than wildlife trade or camera traps that are there. And even other than this, I suppose, now, as I said, across the conservation community, Python is being used and more open source packages are being built. So we never know, at least within next 2 years, I suppose there will be, more packages, open source information available for the conservation community, and it will surely speed up the efforts. So please feel free to ask questions, and if you have any suggestions, yeah. Thank you.
Thank you, Anushree. I think everyone's doing so well on time today that I'm very surprised. This talk has given me a new insight into how difficult things are in the real world. Like when you mentioned some people can put 3 R's in Parrot, this is small problems that are very, that can make a world of difference in your, detecting a fraudulent trade versus, not, right? Like whether you can identify it, and the language barrier, how do you even identify it? And you have multiple codes and all, like double engine, who would have thought it's for a reptile? Right, so.
Yeah, so I guess implementing Python in, real world problems is very much difficult, considering the scope of it. So yeah, we are still trying to get there.
Cool. In terms of contribution to open source or from open source, like I noticed that you rely heavily on open source packages. Are you looking at any packages that you're developing yourself that you can, you can take help from the community?
I talked about collating the wildlife crime reports. So it is going to be an open source tool. So I'm not sure if we can take contributions. Okay. From everybody, but yeah, that is going to be an open source tool, but I'll surely reach out to you once I confirm that. Yeah,
great. There was at least one more thing that I had in mind, but while I don't remember that now, if anyone else has any questions for Anushree, please go ahead and ask. Cool. I think the questions will come later. All right. So Anushree, we had requested Nipun, if you can paste whatever resources that you have on the Discord chat, that will be very helpful. Or you can just send it to me and I'll paste it in the chat and we'll publish it in the notes. Again, thank you so much. I'm sure we'll have more talks from you in the future. I think Ani, we have a small break now, right?
Yeah, we can take a small break. What does everyone think?
If we want to continue, we can. Does anyone want a break?
If you want, just go grab your tea or coffee or water or something.
Yeah, let's take a 2-minute break and be back.
Sure. So we'll be back at 11:25. It's 11:22 right now.
Perfect. In the meantime, if somebody wants to just hang around and talk about something, either related or unrelated to the previous talks, feel free.
So please head over to Meetup QA and post your questions in the chat if speakers can answer them.
And so far. How is everybody finding the platform? Problems? Feedbacks?
Hello?
I had the blinking issue, the screen was blinking, but then it was not there for the first talk. That's all.
Did anyone else face this flickering issue? Was it...
nothing from my...
Cool. So with respect to Anya, with respect to usage of Discord, how is everyone finding it so far? Can we continue to use this in the future? I'm sure it's a shift for most of you from Zoom or Meet or something.
I guess it's fine. Mm-hmm. We are using it for the first time. We are learning, and it's always a learning.
Cool. Thank you. Your handle says Joker, your good name?
Vaseem.
Vaseem. Thanks for attending on a Saturday, Vaseem.
like I my name I mention it as Joker even in a Telegram for all the most of the groups.
That's a handle. That's fine. But just wanted to know. MGR, I think you had a comment or something. Please go ahead.
No. So yeah, Discord is, I think, is much more interactive over here with the chats and stuff rather than the regular Zooms and meets.
Correct. That is part of what we wanted to ensure, that you know, there is no disconnect in terms of communication. Like, see, now we are having this talk and we can seamlessly have a discussion about it on one of the chats, and then even after we can just post all the notes, so it's all in one platform. And I think at least I am liking it a lot, so that is the intention.
Yay. By the way, Python also has a very active Discord server, so
yes,
if you like, I think Abhiram will share the link, or has shared the link already some time ago in general channel.
I'll post it again.
And if you are working on some open source projects, you can also work in the Discord server with the community as well. So there's a lot of very interesting stuff that happens on the Python Discord server.
Yes.
Abhiram, I had a question here. Like, not relevant to the topics as such. Like, I had recently joined to one of the company where I'm working on Java. But then, due to the interest of Python, I had made a small script wherein that will actually load the reports from individual sites. So I had made use of Scrap tool, Scrappy library, beautiful right. soap, and then with couple of requests, I keep on collecting, and then with the help of pandas, I made a like a data frame, and then you know created a HTML file.
One second, Anirudh, can you just mute yourself? Yes. Nice.
All right. Wasim,
please go on.
So yeah, thanks. Thanks for muting. So with that file, you know, I'm interacting with you know, I connected to Jenkins, and then from there, you know, we usually get the daily reports. I'm basically from the QA, from senior MTS. So I made this with my own interest, and then you know, with the little knowledge what I had, I have you know made the script. But then those professional touch is what is missing. Like I have an main, which is an empty file, and then I have written everything in a linear way. Whatever I could make it as a method, I have made it. So can I get any kind of support? Maybe this might be very small to you, but if you can redirect me to someone who can, you know, give me a professional touch in here, so that, you know.
Right, you're looking to get some production level quality code sort of.
Exactly. I'm actually doing a single file. Mentioned everything there.
You can DM me on Discord. I am happy to guide you through it. But it's great that you came up with this, right? So this is the sort of thing that we are missing because of an online setting. Otherwise, you could have just walked up to me in an offline setting and said, "Can you help me out with this?" Right? So thank you for asking this. I'm happy to help you out with this. And in case after the conversion, we'll still, because it's open source, we can still put it on a GitHub repository and put it on the Bang Pipers group as well for more feedback from other experienced Python programmers as well. We have a bunch of them here. So, no problem.
Just one clarification. Like, the URLs what I am traversing using Beautiful Soap or like, you know, internal to our company.
Good enough.
We can't be able to share the code, but then you know we can have a one-to-one connect or something, and I can make a similar code which would be helpful like to others in my own Git repository and share it across here, wherever you say.
Sounds good.
Can I find a time from you or like
after this talk, after the session is fine, man. You can just ping me now, so mm-hmm. I have a handle, and after this talk, we can mm-hmm. have a chat.
That would be great, bro.
Yep. All right.
Abhiram, I think so. You were on mute. Can you repeat that? I don't think so. People heard that.
I was on mute. Was I on mute?
No, I was speaking to you, right? You were on mute.
I think. I don't know what.
I could hear Abhiram also. I think Rahul's.
I was able to hear.
Okay, my bad.
So there is a voice issue.
Okay, so we are learning that, like, this is, there is a selective sort of voice propagation happening, but Vasim, you could hear me, right?
Yeah, we were speaking.
Okay. Alright. Cool. So, yeah, if there are any more questions, please feel free to ask. We'll wait for one more minute before Dr. Anupama takes the stage for the third talk about forecasting in Python. All right. I guess there are no more questions. Okay.
Just a suggestion, like since Vasim did mention, there are different domain-related channels as well. So if you are, say, talking about, say, machine learning or data science stuff, you can post on the relevant channel, and hopefully we'll have more people hanging around on those channels, on those who work on those domains, who can probably help out.
Yes.
Sure, Annie. I will do that. I logged into Discord just to, you know, get into this meetup thing. I haven't explored this much. I'll start looking into it.
This is nice. All right, Dr. Anupama, you can present your screen and stuff. So,
yeah, thanks, Abhiram. And thank you all. I'll share my screen. I hope all of you can see my screen now.
Yes, clicking on the watch stream thing.
Okay. I'm talking about a fairly niche area because it was good to see the other speakers, you know, talk about a lot of these open source packages and things in Python. This one is, the data is sort of proprietary to the company where I work, that is Sabre Travel Technologies. It's a very big company in the US, but it has a big presence in India as well, in about more than 2,000 employees here. What I found is many people haven't heard of this company. But what we use data for is in airlines. So airlines are our customers, like United Airlines, Indigo. We have customers all over the world, and we help them predict a lot of things. Some things are like, you know, crew planning, itinerary, if they want to add an itinerary or remove an itinerary, what will be the impact on their profits, revenue management. So there's a lot of things that goes on. But I'm specifically talking about a problem that I've been working on in the last maybe half year, which is airline market demand forecasting. So in general, I wasn't sure about the audience here, so I'm going to talk a little bit about forecasting in general, time series and all that. If it is a little elementary, I can speed up. Forecasting is, like the word suggests, it's just predicting the future. And there are some very well-known truths and maybe overused sayings about forecasting, and one is that, you know, forecasts are always wrong. So that is true, because if you're able to predict with 100% accuracy, then it's not a forecast, right? It's something like reality, and the uncertainty is what a forecast is. So basically, but just because it is always wrong, it doesn't mean that you shouldn't try to focus. You would actually want to know, I mean, if you can say, this is my focus and this is how much I over or under predict, and this is the level of accuracy that I can give you, then this is a good insight and it helps people plan their products, their offerings and so on. And another very often repeated thing is, if you must forecast, forecast often, because the more and more you average, the better your forecast is. So it's actually good to, you know, throw a lot of models and bring up a lot of forecasts. And the best thing, if you, sorry.
No, no, I think that's a stray. Mike, please go on.
Yeah. So if you want to get better at forecasting, then actually it is what all data scientists are told. It's like, understand your data really well, right? So understand the present, understand the past, mm-hmm. and you will be able to make better predictions. So these are, I mean, if you look at any time series forecasting book, you will see things like this. So typically a time series, what we mean is that there is a timestamp on each data point, right? So if you look at the figure on the left, these are Johnson & Johnson's quarterly earnings. And if you look from, so this plot is from 1960 to 1980, and you can see that steadily the earnings have been increasing. So this kind of data is what we call a time series. So because each quarterly earnings has a timestamp associated with it, and you're looking at it for a reasonably long period of time. These slightly different colored ones are the forecasts. So if you look, the dashed line in blue is what we would predict as the quarterly earnings after, maybe 1985 or so. And the shaded region is the uncertainty period around it. So they are called confidence intervals. And so you're saying your your actual value could be anywhere in that region. So these are all like fairly common terms that you would have heard if you've even read a little bit about time series forecasting. So the historical data is called training data, and we use it to predict something in the future, and that is called the period where we do the prediction is called a test period. So there are various models that we can use, and when we use a model to actually describe the data that we use, we call it fitting the model. So these are, if you look now at the figure on the right, then the raw value, which is in blue, is the actual data, the points that you see. The ones in orange are the fitted value. And that means this is what your model thinks the data is at. And the one in green is the forecast value. So the model, if you can draw a line through the orange dots, that's where the future is. So the T is the end of the, capital T is the end of the time period, which is the training period. And then the green dots are where you predict. So yeah, this is just a brief introduction to time series forecasting. Now I'll give you an introduction of the kind of problem that we are looking at, right, in market size estimation. So market size estimation is a fairly important problem when you look at global air travel, because if you know how many passengers are going to travel to a particular area, then it helps you allocate resources better. Airlines know, so they can manage their fleet better. So it helps in a lot of things. So this is a problem that pretty much anyone in airlines is constantly working on. It's a fairly old problem. There's nothing novel about it. But of course, the tools are always evolving, so we want to try and get better and better at it. And then, so the air traffic data set is not something I can share in a public forum because we do some estimation even to get the air traffic. So that is, like people before me said, it involves some web scraping, some subscribed, some sources that we subscribe to, like, you know, some airlines, some airports and so on. But air traffic, that is passenger counts, is the actual numbers are something which are always difficult to come by. And so this problem where we want to predict how many passengers travel from a particular origin to a destination can be done at many different levels. So you can do it at a city level, right? Like say from Delhi to Mumbai. Or you can do it at a country level, like India to Malaysia, something like that. Or you can even look at, you know, airport to airport, which is what we call origin destination. And then there is a leg and a segment. Leg means it's like an uninterrupted journey. So it would be, so for Delhi to Mumbai, you can actually go through, I mean, I don't know, maybe you you get a strange ticket and you go via Calcutta or something like that. So the leg then will be the Delhi-Calcutta part. The non-stop part is called the leg. And then in a full itinerary, so there can be some parts where it is a non-stop, as in you don't actually deplane and get back on, but there is a stop where the flight number is the same. So that is called a segment. So yeah, basically what I'm alluding to is that you can actually break up this problem and predict air traffic at many different levels. And this depends on who's asking for it. And there are also different sources of information which can help you, estimate your future demand. So these are like, I mean, even a country's GDP can, help you say that, okay, this is a rich country, so most people will be, traveling by air. For example, the United States, which has a lot of air traffic, versus, a developing country where there may not be that many people flying. So there are variables that we can use to help us with the future demand, which is not only historical passenger counts. And then there are things like, route itself, you can look at, short-term routes, which are, which means, at the bottom of my slide here, which is I only predict the future 12 months. Then there is a medium term where you predict up to 3 years ahead, and even up to 120 months, which you can do at a quarterly country pair level. So, I mean, basically there are many combinations that you can decide to do this prediction at. And it depends on your customer and what they want. So this is a typical scenario which I deal with. So suppose I just look at, this Bombay-Delhi route, and I want to estimate the number of passengers who travel from Bombay to Delhi. So this is actually a directional problem. So Bombay to Delhi market might be different from Delhi to Bombay. So we actually treat them as independent markets. But there are also cases when you don't care about the direction. You just want the total number of passengers who travel between Bombay and Delhi. And then you actually aggregate it and then fit another model to it. So this is a brief description of what we are trying to solve. So in time series parlance, we actually label, like I told you, this Y1 to YT minus 1 are data points. And each of them, like Y1 is the one subscript there, actually is the timestamp for it. So T minus 1 is the end of the data period for which I have the data. And so I'm training, I'm fitting. This is called the training data, where my model will be trained on this data. And in the future, when I want to predict that time horizon, I call as H, small h. So from T to T plus H is what I want to predict. So this is just a look into the mathematical part where the capital T is the frequency. For our particular problem, we can look at, you know, data with the monthly frequency. And so H is the time horizon. It takes all the observations beyond T minus 1 to T plus H. And so as I've already told you, like this directional and non-directional case, we have to fit a model for each market because I mean, though we can try some sort of multivariate models where, you know, even the market is an input, we find that it generally doesn't work that well. So it's better to, you know, build models individually for each market. So there are various forecasting methods. You'll be surprised to know that there are still, so there are qualitative and quantitative methods. So the qualitative methods actually rely a lot on, you know, market research. So there is a representative judgment. You will actually be surprised that even in many big companies, these kind of predictions are made based on experience. So there are people who have 30 years experience and then, you know, they say that this is what will happen. And it's in fact... this kind of heuristic prediction is hard to beat, and so this is what sometimes is still happening in a lot of places. But we quantitative methods are surely taking over, especially with you know, the advances in machine learning and so on. So we make so time series has a traditional algorithms which have always been used. So they break down the time series into trend and seasonality, and there are these very well-known methods like exponential smoothing, ARIMA, which is an autoregressive moving average method to make predictions. And then there are also these econometric methods, causal econometric methods, which when you have additional data which help you make the predictions, these are actually better. So both exist and both are still being used. So this is just a brief thing. So this is a look at the data. Again, I mean, so the Python that I used is very simple. I want to make that statement up front. So probably, I mean, from what I've seen of the audience, it looks like you all write your own packages, you're making contributions and so on. So we are, I mean, at least what I've done here is just used things which are freely available. So this is just a describe part of the data set. And if you look here, the origin and destination is Bombay, Dubai. And we have other variables like, you know, flight ID, departure time, arrival time, departure date, arrival date, and then there is a cabin. So there are various fields that you can get. So there is a capacity depending on the kind of flight. So, you know, whether it's a Boeing or whatever. And there are cabin bookings, and then there is a fare per booking and so on. So there are various information that we can use to leverage our predictions. And then we also use Seaborn to, you know, explore our data set. So some of the variables I showed you earlier, this is just a simple, like, you know, between one variable to the other, we are looking at the kind of correlations that exist. So these are things that any data scientist would do before you start thinking of models. So one is this correlation plot. So, you know, this again, Seaborn is what I used. It's called, I imported it as SNS. So with a heat map, you can see the kind of correlation that exists between the variables. And if you can see, cabin bookings and cabin capacity are highly correlated. They're almost like, I mean, 95%. So you can just use one or the other. So then we can, once you're fairly sure of the kind of variables you want to use of your data set, that there is no missing data and there are no strange looking outliers and so on, then you can think about methods. So one of the first things we tried was a naive method, a seasonal naive method, which is that basically because we find that this passenger count is very seasonal, it's one method is to just use the previous season's value. So suppose you're predicting, so on the right here is the passenger count over the different years. So if you can see, the pattern is actually very similar across the months. And between 2010 and 2017, it's only that the passenger count has increased. So if you know the factor, it's pretty much, so all the Februaries are on the same sort of point on the curve, and April and so on. So it is a start. I mean, it's not the best thing you can do, but what you would do is you would say y of t plus h is equal to y of t. So you would say that, if I want to predict February 2018, then let me just use February 2017. So this is actually a method which forecasters use, and it's called naive because it's so simple. So here, because we're looking at monthly frequency, we would actually say that seasonality is annual, so we would say that this is e plus h minus 12. So Facebook profit model is something which is an open source model shared by Facebook, by their data science team. It is actually a very popular model for time series with strong seasonal trends. And, if you have several seasons of historical data, it's actually one of the best performing models. And then it is fast. You can also tune it, tune the hyperparameters and so on. And you have it both in R and Python. So this is, especially for data like what I showed you, this is a very good model. So in the training, so using the profit package in Python, if you just fit it for one particular like I showed you, right? Like say for a particular flight ID and a cabin, if you just allow profit to run and spit out a model, then this is how it looks. So it also gives you a confidence interval. It keeps optimizing, so the horizon, it keeps increasing it up to the point that you want. And then it also, the profit metric is also inbuilt in the package, and it gives you the error metrics in these many formats. So let me talk about error metrics. Again, if you're a forecaster, then these will be fairly, common. So MAP is one of the metrics I like, because if I say my method has a 5% error, it immediately helps everyone visualize, how good the measure is. Whereas MSE and RMSE, which are, mean square error and root mean square error, don't give you that kind of immediate sense of how good your model is doing. So MAP is nothing but, the actual value minus the forecasted value divided by the actual value. Then you take the mean across all your prediction points and multiply it by 100. So, MAP is one which is fairly commonly used. When we are dealing with airline data, we actually use something called a weighted mean absolute percentage error, where we weight it with the actual number of passengers. Because if you look at I might say Delhi, Bombay, I'm able to predict with 5% accuracy. Whereas Varanasi, Delhi, I predict with like, you know, 8% accuracy. So your immediate thought is that, oh, the model did better with the Delhi-Bombay itinerary rather than the Varanasi-Delhi itinerary. But that's not really true, because if you look at the volume of passengers who travel between Delhi and Bombay, that would be much more than the volume of passengers between say Varanasi and Delhi. So if you weight it by the actual number of passengers, you actually get a better sense of the overall performance of your model. So this is what we use. And then there's also this root mean square percentage error. So we do a bunch of these things, but finally when you have to talk to a product manager or someone in an airline, then you'll probably use the WMAP. Yeah, so actually, I mean, I don't know how I'm doing on time. I might have finished very early.
You're fine.
Okay. Yeah, so unfortunately, I can't share our results for all the markets, but I think I've given you kind of a sense. So like I said, I mean, there are various markets for which we do this, and we the final results that we look at are in the form of WMAP. Then, I mean, these actually go, these actually then are, you know, taken to the marketing team or the sales team and so on, and then finally to the customer. I mean, we are looking at, you know, making a tool sort of thing where you can just plug in on a particular origin and destination, and then it'll tell you that this is the predicted market size for the next year. So for that we need to get it into production, and we're looking at, you know, moving it to the cloud and so on. So far this Python model can if you're just running like say 1,000 markets, it could easily run on your laptop. For a company like Sabre, you know, there are about 1 million markets. So when you want to get the market sizes for all of them and train models for all of them, then we typically look at running it on the cloud. And that's where, you know, doing it in Python really helps. So this finally, I want to also talk about something like, you know, where forecasting fails. So if you look at the data which I showed you, where it's fairly, you know, very predictable because year on year you're seeing the same behavior, then you don't need fancy models like Facebook's Prophet. But models like Prophet help is when historical data actually fails. So this happened when it definitely happened during the pandemic when, you know, suddenly all the air traffic just completely went to zero. But it also happened earlier in 2017 in the Doha to Dubai market, where there was a diplomatic crisis and they actually stopped flying. So, I mean, there's no way that, you know, your forecasting algorithm can pick up on this. So the green is where your algorithm predicts you will be, given that, you know, there is a significant upward trend. It thinks that this trend will continue into 2018. But what happened was actually it went down to zero. So this again happened in March 2020, where suddenly all the flights were grounded. How we could, predict even in the case of these kind of failures is something like this Prophet model, where if we have additional data, like, you know, advanced booking data, which tells you that, you know, oh, bookings are falling. So this will not follow the trend that has been there for the past 10 years. So those are the kind of things which can help you overcome these kind of sudden changes. So these are the key takeaways that I would like to give the audience. So one is we are using data to better understand the market. This was essentially a supervised learning method where we know what the data is and we are using it to predict passenger demand. And always first, you know, explore, visualize data, look for patterns, understand the data really well before jumping into modeling it. Fit your models and make predictions. Of course, there are all these great packages which do very advanced math, and but I mean, for us it's just a one line or two lines of code. So yeah, that's my talk. So I'll be happy to take questions.
Cool. Dr. Anupama, thank you so much. Yeah, we are.
I have a question. So you showed the data set, right? So I mean, at least in real world, apart from airlines, there are other scenarios where there could be zero demand, right? So like, do you have any strategies to tackle them or something like that? Because like, at least for stats models like whole winter and stuff, they are very dependent on what's happening in the recent past.
So. Correct. Yeah. So, what you're saying is correct. Holt Winters, exponential, or any of the exponential smoothing, even ARIMA, they all fail very badly when things like this happen, right? Like the pandemic or like the Doha to Dubai situation, which I told you. So, there is no way that, you know, these models will be able to predict these kind of sudden disturbances. So these kind of breaks are also it's a field in forecasting itself where, you know, typically what people would do is when there were such breaks, right? One example is also the 2008 financial crash in the US. I mean, it was all over the world, but I think the US was heavily impacted. So there, what happens is whenever you make a prediction, you actually throw away data before 2008, because instead of helping your prediction beyond that, beyond that time frame, it actually makes it worse. So so these are some strategies by which forecasters deal with the, you know, these kind of sudden drops. So the best thing is actually, I mean, even a simple regression with additional data will probably do better than a Holt Winters or an ARIMA model. So that is the only thing that I found that will help in these cases. There are these zero cases which you're asking about, even in very big markets, that what happens is there's a new player and they want to introduce, you know, a new airline in a particular route, or they want to some studies actually look at the so London, you know, already has 5 airports. Each time a new airport was added, they do a study and look at, you know, whether adding an airport is actually going to help. Will it take away some traffic from Heathrow, for example? So in all those cases, we actually start from a blank slate, right? We think there's nothing to help us there. So the geography. So what you rely on is something close to it. So then you do some clustering, look at similar markets and see what happened there, and then try and apply it to these kind of new things.
Okay. And also, can I ask another question?
Yeah, please.
Yeah,
go on.
So I was asking Anupama about like, how do you capture the effect of holidays and stuff like that?
Actually the profit model that way is very good. They do have parameters for weekends, weekdays and holidays and all that. But actually, you know, passenger demand that way is very good, because you see very high passenger demand during the holiday season, as it is called. Like, you know, December is typically a time for high demand. Summer, especially in European countries, sees a high demand. And actually the low demand times are like, you know, in between, like February, March, and maybe September sort of time. So again, I mean, especially in the US market, you will see that holidays see a lot more demand. So, yeah, these are parameters in our models.
Can I ask a question, please?
So you have clear seasonal.
So the question I have is, it was a very informative talk on the analytical part of it in terms of what you do with the data. Because I understand Sabre is like a very old company in the US and now in India also. Can you throw a light on the infrastructure? So all these things that you're doing is, I don't know if I'm right, but some of your systems may still may be in mainframe, or you kind of migrated into newer machines. So because the reason I know that is I was in Dallas for some time, so that's how I know about this company. So yeah. That is where I wanted to understand, like, how are you interfacing data from your different you have a lot of legacy code, I'm assuming all your code is monolithic, or have you all migrated to microservices, or are you in the process of doing it, and do you use some cutting edge technology in terms of infrastructure like Kubernetes? Just if you can throw some light on infra part, that would be great. Thanks.
Yeah, you're correct in the sense, yes, it is a so the data part is a big dinosaur. It had been in mainframes, but very recently. So actually, you know, disclaimer here is that I joined Sabre only 2 years back. I do know that there are a lot of legacy code, data, and everything in place, but the change is happening slowly and steadily. In fact, the data has been moved to a lot of better servers is what I mean. I'm not too sure about data warehousing part, but the move from mainframes has definitely happened. And there is also, a push to get into microservices. Like I said, even this market size estimation will be a microservice in the very near future. And there are also, things which are, programs which have been in place for, maybe 20 years, which is like, you know, this crew planning, fleet management and all that. So those are also being converted to use the sort of latest techniques and so on. So there is a steady push. It's been happening over the 2 years that I've been in the company. Like in all companies, you know, some happen fairly without any hiccups, and they are very quick. Some take a little more time, but the push is there.
So you're saying your Python code can also run on mainframe? Is that something that you know?
No. Okay. What I mean to say is, I think we've moved out of my mainframes. I may be wrong, but whatever.
So whatever Python code you're running, right? So they are pretty much on the cloud. Is that right?
Yeah.
Okay.
So when I joined the company, it was actually Amazon Web Services. Now we are using Google Cloud. So.
Okay. So that being the case, so the assumption is they have moved to virtual machines and pretty much like a monolithic. But as you said, they are slowly moving to microservices also. So in that being said, you may not use Kubernetes. Is that right?
No, I think that is more horses for courses sort of thing. So Kubernetes might be being used in other programs. I'm not aware.
Okay, fine. Okay, yeah. Thank you.
So one of the reasons I enjoyed this talk is because I work in demand forecasting. So it's like all of the concepts are a daily sort of jargon for me. So I really enjoyed how it is to see in a singular field in aircraft, in flight management and in terms of forecasting flights, right? So it is very nice to hear all the familiar.
Then it would have probably been something you already know is always difficult to listen to. So
it is good to hear about how people in other companies are handling this sort of data as well, and it's some sort of reassurance that you are not going way off the actual required track to be beaten on, right?
Okay.
So that's nice to know.
And one thing you said was like people are building packages and you are using what is already, that is I think underselling it, because using a package to its like squeezing every bit of efficiency from a package is just as important as, you know, like inventing something afresh, because like if you are reinventing the wheel, that is as much of a time waste as it is to, you know, like use a pro application half-heartedly. So I think
exactly. Yeah, I completely agree. So I actually, I mean, I'm fine with using, you know, all these ready-made packages, which a lot of people have put effort into. But it is seriously great to see, you know, a package like Prophet or, I mean, even XGBoost, which came out of Microsoft, I think, you know, freely available, and people can just download and use it for their own purposes. So it's good.
Yeah, it speaks to the reputation of the companies that develop it also. So I think it is like a win-win for everyone. Someone like Facebook is putting it out there. First of all, we trust their reputation. And second thing is, like, because it is open source, it is useful for everyone. They can customize it and so.
Correct.
There was at least one more question that I had. One comment. Forgot. Okay, if anyone else has any questions for Dr. Anupama, now is the time.
Yeah, I had one.
Yes.
Towards the end, like Anupama was showing like where the forecast failed, right? Say, take the situation where COVID happened, and all the models that were built out were suddenly like put out of work, because like this is a random event that happened. How do you deal with it? Do you, when things are back to normal, do you tweak your data or do you tweak your models to include this anomaly?
It is a very, very tough situation for forecasters. So what we do now is actually, in the months when we had to forecast, you know, passenger demand, like for example, in July 2020 for the US, it was pretty much zero. So none of the traditional models would give you a value zero, right? I mean, they would give you some, maybe like even Prophet would give you some low value, but not that low. So at that point, we you know, put in some sort of heuristic scaling. Like we say that, you know, look at something like after 9/11, when I mean, that was another major disturbance in the airline demand. So if we have, I mean, for many airlines, we didn't have the data that far back. So it's basically, we introduce like some sort of heuristic scaling. So, you know, say that it's like 0.1 of what it was last year. And that was till demand started picking up again around the end of 2020. I mean, not in not everywhere, but it did pick up to like, you know, 20%. So it wasn't exactly forecasting, I would say. It is more like I said, experience based, judgment based predictions. So and even now when things are picking up, there is a lot of so you would have heard, you know, everywhere people say it'll be a V-shaped recovery, no, or it'll be a U-shaped recovery and all that. I mean, these are all guesses and no one knows what will really happen. So what we can do is, you know, look at advance bookings. So people are starting to book 6 months in advance for their holiday, like, you know, spring break and so on. So we use that data to make, to help our predictions a little more.
Thank you.
I remember the question I had actually. So I was asking about, I was wondering about the engineering part of things. You said Python works for you because, I mean, like in your models and all, right? So in terms of engineering, do you also use Spark and stuff, or is it a distributed model is not really required?
No, actually, a distributed model is very helpful because, like I said, we have about, you know, a million markets for which we have to make these predictions. Yeah. So the thing is, actually, when we when we were working with Amazon, you know, AWS, then PySpark was actually helpful. But since moving to Google Cloud, we haven't really been using Spark. So this is something I'm currently working on, actually, you know, how to make it batch process and distributed across clusters and all that. So yeah, I'm still not on top of the Google Cloud offerings. So yeah, I'm definitely not using Spark, but I'm looking at some solution. So the Kubernetes someone suggested, but I still haven't yet had time to look at that.
Right, right. That's also cluster management sort of platform.
Yeah.
Cool. Okay. Maybe we can have a chat about that sometime. All right. So, are there any more questions? If not, we will slowly segue into the open house session. I guess we will now. So basically, what this is about is the silence will not help. This is expected to be a little bit more of an interactive sort of thing. First of all, Dr. Anupama, thank you so much for presenting. Right, it was very useful for me at least, but I'm sure for everyone else as well. So what we want to do in this open house session is talk about other people in the audience, how they are using Python in the wild, so to speak. If anyone wants to proffer a sort of use case that they are using in their work or in their academia, we've had students also. So you can speak up now, and it'll be good to hear the speakers, Anupama and Anushree. I don't think we have Nipun again, so it'll be good to hear their take on what you are doing, vice versa. So anyone can speak up.
I'm Rajnikant. I work for Jibata.
Hi, I'll just tell one use case which I use Python exclusively for. So I work in air quality domain, and so we collect camera images from traffic signals to see what is the number of vehicles on the road and try to give some emission factors to it. So I think OpenCV and computer vision is something what I use Python for.
Cool. I think Reddy PDL was
Yeah, I'm Rajnikant Reddy. I work for Jupyter.
I was just inquisitive. So Nipun had shared that he was using some R and he was using Python to do that, right? I mean, at least in the forecasting domain, I've been like, I've been into like for the past 3 months, and most of the packages like are somewhat mature in R, right? So do you like tackle that? You write your own package, or like what do you do about that?
Right, we'll come to that question, MGR. I think there is some audio problem, which is why Rajnikant Reddy is not able to get through to everyone. But we're going to let him go first, and then we'll come back to the question. I've taken in the question. Is that fine?
Sure, yeah.
Yes, please, Rajnikant, please go on.
Yeah, are you able to hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you fine. I think some people can't.
Yeah, we hear you fine, yeah.
Okay, yeah. I work for Jibet Technologies, Bangalore. Predominantly, I use Python for all our test automation needs. I use PyTest heavily in all my projects. We use Android for Android automation. There's a library called UI Automator. And for the web automation, currently latest Python package called Playwright from Microsoft. This is almost like the next version of Google Puppeteer tool. Okay, we use that. And almost all the packages like Paramico for all device management to SSH. Okay. Yeah, that's it from my side.
Thank you. Python is pretty dominant in the automation sector as well. So all of these packages are helpful. Like when we put it out there, right? So you'll get to know if people are not aware of them, and you know, maybe you can adopt them in your own workforce. So thank you, Rajnikant.
I think I had the audio issue, so could you maybe just put in those packages that you mentioned on one of the channels?
Yeah,
Yeah, sure, sure.
The Microsoft one, which is a Puppeteer alternative, you said?
Yeah, it's a plethora. I'll put all of it.
Thanks.
So, yeah, we'll go to MGS question. Just one second. Who asked the question about the automation?
Sorry, that was me. If you're asking, my name is Abdi Ali. You can just call me Ali.
Ali, you were high up on the roster, so I couldn't see who was speaking.
Okay. Yeah, I think I must have misplaced you on the list.
MGR, you were asking, there are a lot of packages in R also for forecasting if one of them would be better suited than the other, right? So, first of all, your good name, please.
My name is Vignesh.
MGR fan, yeah. Sorry. Okay, so, so the reason, I've used R in the past as well, and Aditi here can speak a lot more about R, but the reason I think people prefer data scientists prefer Python to R is because of its easy integration with the rest of the infrastructure, right? It is not just about data science work. So if your output was just intended to be CSV and Parquet files, where you can then consume them on a historical basis in a batch manner or something, then I think R is still okay. Some of our data scientists even use R for forecasting. But in Python, you have those libraries and more, right? So you can easily integrate with Airflow or Prefect. And then you can, if you're doing distributed, like I mentioned before, you can use Spark, PySpark. And the bindings with Python for different sort of different parts of the workflow, overall workflow, right from requirement solicitation all the way up to deployment, I think Python facilitates that a lot more. Like if you see, even Julia is picking up in some sort of in data science. But the reason people don't use it is because it is very niche and it is siloed in its own sort of domain. People who are good at it are good at it, but how do you talk to the rest of the entire system, right? Like for example, Anupama mentioned talking to product managers and how you talk about MAPE and stuff. So some of those implementations might not be suited for in R. You can't just stay in your own playpen, so to speak. So that's why I think people use Python a lot more.
So, let me also pitch in here. Actually, I would say that you're right in the sense that Biram, the MGR fan, but that these packages, right, especially the forecast package in R, is very, very difficult to beat in terms of the time it takes to fit and predict models. And if you just take Auto Arima, right, for one market, it takes a few seconds in R, whereas the same Auto Arima in Python takes about a minute. Which is completely unacceptable. I mean, if it takes like 60 times more, 60x the time, then I could have done 60 more predictions in that time, right? The simple reason is that statisticians prefer R because R was basically written by two statisticians. Mm-hmm. And is still maintained by statisticians. So the mm-hmm. thing is, even if you look at the profit model, I guess the R model came first. So if you look at the model per se, I would say that it's still better in R. But like Abhiram mentioned, because of the integration with all the pipelines, right? And finally, like MLOps and where you sit in that, building data pipelines, data engineering and all that, where you are in the bigger picture, finally, when you have to talk to a developer, you talk the same language when you do it in Python, basically. So, but it's not that R is gone, because in Google Cloud, though the interface is a notebook, pretty much whatever you can do in Python, you can do in R there as well. So there are packages being written to support R in the cloud. So they are called Google Cloud something. So it's basically, it's so far advanced that you can't just say that you can do without one or the other. My guess is both will continue to exist together, and I mean, you can do a lot of testing on your laptop in R, and then finally when you deploy, you probably convert it to Python and so on. So someone was talking about a converter, right, where you convert R code to Python. Those kind of packages will be really useful, actually.
Yeah, RPy2 is what we use. It is not as good as someone actually doing it, because you know, parsing rules are rigid, right? So if you need something more optimal, then you'll have to do it by hand. So it's good to know both languages, because one offers better performance and one offers better integration. So pick your poisons and, you know, like, drink them both. So
that's great. Okay.
Sorry, RPy2 does automated conversion of Python code to R code and vice versa? I thought it just does the data structure mapping thing.
Converts R to Python, not vice versa.
Like the actual code, like it has a transpiler logic over there.
Yes.
I see. I only used it for converting like pandas data frames to data tables in R and then using them in Jupyter Notebook. I didn't know it does code translation. Interesting.
I used it in 2014. Yeah, that's when I used it.
I see. Doesn't RPy2 though just actually run an R interpreter in the background, or just like, you know how Py4j and all of those kind of utilities work? Just transfers the data to an R environment, runs it and gets you back the code.
I'll take your word for it, because like in terms of memory, like I'm terribly failing, and I'm sure now there are better ways to convert it also. I don't even know if that library is it's improved, or if there's a different way to do it. So, because like I said,
sure.
Thank you.
Okay, sir. That was very, very informative. Yeah.
Thank you. Please ask any more questions.
Anupama was suggesting that she was exploring means to have analytics done on in a scalable manner, right? I wanted to understand if she considered using Dask and Ray, like the options that are available, and I'm seeing people using them. These are picking up speed, yeah. So I wanted to understand, like, what are the things Anupama was exploring?
Oh no, I've not heard of them at all. So if you can put it up, I would be interested in exploring that. Yeah, so I mean, the extent of making it scalable is, like I said, you know, making it a distributed sort of thing, where, because I mean, we are fitting a model for each market. I mean, and you have the power of the cloud, so I run it, you know, in a serial fashion. So that is the thing that I was going to explore. But yeah, I'm interested in what you're saying. So if you can put
it
up.
Let me share it on Meetup QA, maybe. Yeah.
Yeah. Thanks.
Yeah, and there was this talk by one of our previous speakers also on Dask. So I can link the recording, the video of the recording also on one of the channels, maybe, that Dr. Anupama can look at. So Dask basically lets you parallelize code on your local system by making use of the cores, and Spark takes that one level higher by utilizing clusters across the board. Now, because you're leveraging the power of the cloud, a lot of it is, you know, like off-handed to the cloud, handed off to the cloud. So that's probably why you can afford to concentrate just on the model building and let deployment happen there. But yeah, like when you're trying to localize performance and try to, you know, see how best you can get it on a local system before porting the same thing on production, I think these sort of tools like Dask and the other things also. Something starts with V. Veo. V-A-E-O. Vakes. V-A-E-X. Correct. Vakes is also there.
How about Ray? Ray is also...
Ray, Modin and all are a little bit immature, I think. But Wakes and Dask are production level.
Okay, I see.
Yeah.
Doesn't Dask support integrating with Yarn also? Like, if I have a Yarn cluster.
Yeah, so Yarn is just another resource, literally. Yet another resource, what is the last thing? Allocator, so manager. So it does integrate with a bunch of these node managers and resource allocators. Maybe someone who's not yet piped up, Shrikant, Renuka, Sheetal. I'm forgetting Shikhar's actual name. I'm sorry, you joined us today. Thank you so much.
Yeah, it's Rishti.
Yeah. Any comments about how you are using Python Network?
Currently, I'm not using Python Network, but yeah, I just want to explore it for like side projects and yeah, just I'm curious about learning Python in general. So yeah, yep. So learning from you all, lots of things, new libraries.
Hi, Sushri.
Hey, Rahul.
Welcome, colleagues. Shrikant. Any comments? I guess not. All right.
Anybody works on like non-analytical sort of domains as well who has joined today? Maybe web dev, core Python, something else.
Actually, we use Python for a lot of things in my company. We do analytics stuff too with Spark, Pandas and all of that stuff, but a lot of it is also web development, DevOps, infrastructure management, and so on and so forth.
Nice, nice.
Which company? Abdi.
Yeah, sorry?
Which company is it?
Oh, it's a US-based company, which is quite small, it's around 15 people or so. It's called Corridor Platforms. We work in the financial analytics domain.
Oh, cool. Okay. Corridor.
Corridor platform. Okay. Yeah, yeah. One of the things I was, you know, like taking away from the last talk was, we really need to figure out someone who can like make nice names like Profit. I really like the name that Facebook gave. We have very different names.
Yeah, very very pertinent, right? Like when you look at the diviner in the pic that Anupama had shared, Profit seems logical.
Yeah.
By the way, where in the infra side of things do you use Python, if you don't mind sharing?
Yeah, sure. So we are essentially a software provider. So we basically just give people Python packages and so on and so forth. We don't use it as much for, let's say, infrastructure provisioning and all that stuff, right? Because we're not like a SaaS provider. So what we kind of do is we just need to figure out how to bundle Python applications, which is a nightmare in general with packaging, figuring out dependencies, embedded dependencies for C, Java, all of those kind of things. So that's the kind of DevOps that I was talking about.
Right. Interesting. By the way, just a quick... addition in a sort of tangent direction. If somebody wants to present talks at the following Bank Pipers events, we do open CFP, so keep a watch on that, on obviously on the Discord and on the social handles as well. And the CFP for Flascon and Pi Cascadas is open right now. So if you want to present a talk in those, you can feel free to do so.
Oh, yes. Flascon is coming up. Both Ami and me are sort of co-organizers along with the main guy, Abdur.
Yes.
So this is a global event. So you want to get in on that if you're a Flask developer.
Yeah, Flascon is in December and Pi Cascadas is in February. So both are excellent events.
What is Pi Cascada?
Pi Cascadas, so it's there. I have shared in the events channel some time ago, like October sometime.
Pi Cascades, okay.
Pi Cascades, yeah. Okay. I don't know if I pronounced it wrong.
No, I think I heard it wrong. Okay.
There's a band called Cascada back in the day.
It's a pretty big conference. Like last time I attended their dev sprint, it was pretty cool.
Nice.
We sort of modeled the entire PyCon India dev sprint after that.
Oh.
Annie, you were asking something, right? Other than machine learning people, who else are using PyCon?
Yeah. Please, feel free to share.
Actually, I'm using Discord for FSM, so I couldn't get that unmute button. I was just exploring some other things.
I see. So there is, if you click on that where it is written voice connected below that, and uh-huh. then on your right hand side, there is a pop out option. So then you will get like all the mute and video and all that options like a regular.
Got it. Like initially I had connected with a VPN and then VPN was blocking Discord. And then I had to connect with this. Okay. I am using it for the reporting purpose. There were certain test cases which are getting executed. So those reports go and sit in different folders. That's where I felt like using the beautiful soap, I'll be able to traverse and then get the details. So nice. I'm using it.
I haven't used beautiful soap in quite a while.
Even I haven't used it, but when I saw a couple of videos and all, then I realized that okay, this could be cool enough. Without using Selenium, we can still get in and then get what required data.
Yeah, pretty cool.
Go on. Okay, so this question is both for Rajnikant Reddy and for Wasim. So when you're using Selenium, do you have Python drivers for them already?
Many use Java by default. I think if you are little bit conscious, right, you choose Python because it has all other packages which need for automation.
Selenium drivers, we usually download it from Selenium pub website. And then that's where we make use of it.
I have actually only used Selenium with Python. I've not used
started with Python, they tend to use all Python bindings only. And for most of the popular packages you have Python bindings. That's the beauty of Python.
Nice.
And in fact, practically, we have, we are a small team from our company side, but we do have a vendor team who is supporting us. So when we used to debug any issues and all, we feel a bit difficult. Like practically, when we use the same thing with the Java, we had to compile and then run, and then we cannot change anything in between. If you are using IntelliJ as an IDE, then that's a different case where you can do exceptional, execute example something, some additional feature. But then with the Python, so what I usually do is I open a command prompt and then add import two libraries, Selenium WebDriver and then other web elements, and then that's it. I open the browser and we can start debugging. The main intention of using Python with Selenium for my current project is we end up in a situation where we have to identify whether the element does exist or whether we get appropriate data for a given things. So those things are very handy enough to start debugging in runtime. But that's not that's not the case when it comes with Java and all.
Yeah, the idle REPL, that's the entire reason for Python, not the entire, but at least one of the reasons why Python shot up in fame for easy runtime debugging and stuff. So that is a good point that you touched upon.
Yeah.
Cool.
Abram, I had a question for Anushree.
Yes, please.
First of all, thanks for listing out all the packages that you were using, Anushree. The question I had was given that all the metrics that you'll be collecting, One might be through those cameras, right? The infrared motion sensing cameras and all those. Are you using like any cheap computes like RPy and associated Python libraries and packages for those? Any part of the data collection process? Or all?
Yeah.
Okay.
I work camera trap. But yeah, like as I
No, it's robotic.
Yeah, myself, I'm here.
Fine, yeah. Fine, yeah.
Yeah, but
everyone's voice is like that.
No, even I heard like that, like ground the voice.
It's our voice.
I wonder if it's a Discord limitation.
There's actually less people now, so shouldn't be. But maybe try refreshing your
browser. But Abhiram's is okay, right? And even Ani, I think. Yeah.
Right now it's fine.
Now it's better. Anushree, can you try speaking again?
No, it's still the same.
If you're on the web app, could you try hardware? If you're on a desktop app, could you try restarting that?
It's like Bender from Futurama.
Yeah.
Right.
Anushree, I'll call you and tell you if you have to refresh, if you're not able to hear us clearly.
I think you should do that, Aditi, because if she can't hear you, she can't even hear this.
Exactly, yeah. Alright, while we wait for Anushree to come back.
Sorry, I just have a question for all the machine learning as data science people. How do you track your experiment?
Hello? I just
want
to
Why is it so scary here? Abhiram, are you able to hear my voice clearly?
Yes. Yes.
Then why is it so scary?
It is scary.
This special effects.
You know. I don't know. It's unfortunate. Like I would have loved to hear Anushree's answer to Rahul's question.
Yeah.
While she comes back, so who asked about the tracking?
Yeah, it's me. Yeah.
So in our company, we are currently exploring, like I've used MLflow in the past for tracking ML experiments. So it offers it's a normal Flask application that you can deploy on any server and you can track different metrics. And so it has its own set of challenges in that it has a rigid folder structure and all, but it is one of the better tools out there. And I have my own makeshift logging stuff. Like I keep making these tiny applications for myself, so I have a Django app that I made to track my logging experiments, but apart from MLflow, I have yet to come across a better tool, and that's saying something because there should be better tools. ML Studio is one of them. I think Neptune is one of them.
I recently tried weights and biases. So
how was it?
From initial thoughts, I would say it's good. But I haven't explored it that much. I just logged to it and I was seeing exploring the graphs, and it's good from the initial stuff. Yeah.
Okay.
What
do you?
Sorry, I am not able to hear you.
No. Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
No, I was asking Dr. Anupama what she uses at Sabre.
Sorry, for what?
For logging experiments and
tracking. Oh. Yeah, so actually, I mean, this part, like I said, right, I mean, since I joined Sabre, I've been mostly working on these independent sort of projects. So this is like the first one which we are taking to this Google Cloud and then tracking and all that. So, yeah, not really. So what we do is sort of primitive, right? We just dump out whatever is, yeah. Logs in the screen and then save it offline as well, and finally the output as well. So things like that, yeah, not any specific thing, but these are interesting inputs actually, what I'm hearing from you.
Abhiram, like there's this one package called MLTrace. If people are following Shreya Shankar, I mean, like she's pretty popular in the ML Twitter space at least. So she has this package called MLTrace.
Okay.
If do check it out, and if this is what you are referring to, the tracing and all the logging that's associated with the ML pipelines.
I am. So
yeah.
What is it deployed in? Is it like a, it's also a Flask app or?
So I'm not exactly sure. I haven't tried it out, but this was something I read about a long time back. So I just thought I'll put it out here.
Nice. Yeah, it is a Flask app. I will try it out. I have never heard of it till now. So thank you.
Sorry, Anushree will not be able to join. Her internet is pretty weak. But I think somebody asked a question about camera traps. She's not currently collecting any camera trap images, but then she says that it's there are many Python bindings for camera trap images.
Oh, good, okay. Good to know that. Yeah.
Yeah, I'm sure. Like at some point, she can come back and offer her inputs also.
Yeah, definitely. I've asked her to type as well, so probably she will do that.
Yeah, if there are no more questions or conversations that people want to start, I think this is a good time as any to wind up. And first of all, I'd like to thank the speakers again. Nipun, he's not here. Anushree and Dr. Anupama, thank you so much for, you know, like, first of all, we did not give you much time for the talks. Okay, it was just like 2 weeks. So thank you so much for indulging us and coming up and spending time on a Saturday, because you have to prepare for the talks also, so that is not taken lightly. Thank you. To the rest of you as well for attending and for sticking around. You've also spared your Saturdays to attend a talk, so it shows a certain amount of buy-in in terms of interest in the language and in the community. So thank you all. If you want to present a talk in the future, like Ani said, we'll be putting out the CFP. Please fill in your like whatever talk you want to present, if not, you can reach out to any of us, me, Anirudh, Ritesh, Aditi, Rahul. All of us are co-organizers here at Bank Pipers. Reach out anytime on the Discord channel, on Twitter, anywhere, right? You can just mail us also. If you have got a mail from us, you can respond back to it. If you have any questions for the speakers, you can put it on the chats in the QA events channel, and if not, we'll see what you all do in the channels in the days to come.
And also, like, it's not a very mandatory thing that we have to organize meetups. If you want to talk about something on the days that we don't organize, let's say not on the third Saturday of every month, feel free to just drop by and just say that you want to just talk about something and join a voice channel or something. Just invite people in. We'd be happy to join whoever is available.
Yes, that's a new avenue that's opened up.
Yeah.
And with the, so I'll just stop the recording and, you know, feel free to continue over here as well.
Yeah, I think we'll wind up now. So.